Good morning. It's great to see you all. As we gather together to worship God this morning, let's still our hearts as we come before Him. Sovereign Lord, we invite you here amongst us, seeking to know you more, to worship you, and to grow in faith. You have blessed us in so many ways. Be pleased to receive these offerings as symbols that we give our all to you. We dedicate them to your glory. Amen. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 63, and if you could repeat the words in bold. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. Let's pray together. Our God in heaven, we thank you that you hear our prayers, that no matter what we go through, we are never truly alone. And no matter how hard things are or difficult we find them, we are never without your resources. We thank you for your grace which redeems us, your arms that protect us, your love that sustains us, your power which enables us, and your Spirit who transforms us. You are indeed worthy of all honor, praise, glory, and thanks. Gracious Lord, forgive us for when we fail to give you the honor due to your name, or the thanks due to your wonderful blessing. Rather than focusing our eyes on you, we can become distracted, take credit for ourselves, and act contrary to your morality. Cleanse us and renew us, Lord. We open our hearts to you. Life lived with you, Lord, is exciting. It's an adventure. It is a life of community, fulfillment, and joy. We thank you that there is so much in our lives which is good. We thank you for the times when life seems easy and that everything is well. But we know that often it is not like that. We feel burdened and tired. We doubt our ability to keep going or to finish a specific task. Things that used to come naturally, we struggle to do. There are times where we see that other people or even different forces are working against us, opposing what we do, especially when we are doing these things in your name. People mock us and seek to demoralize us with taunts. We can get angry, frustrated, or even just left feeling empty. Lord, you see all these things. You know our inmost being, our thoughts and our hearts, and you do not leave us to wander through dark valleys alone. We hand these things over to your justice, honor, and care, seeking your help in our lives, as we also ask for your help in the lives of others, and in the life of our world. Specifically, we name those things most on our hearts to you now in the silence. What we ask is no small thing, but we bring in confidence because we bring them to an infinite God. This prayer and all these prayers we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who also taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our reading this morning is the next section of Nehemiah, which is chapter 4. And we're going from verse 1 through to verse 12. Nehemiah chapter 4, from verse 1. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are? Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, What they are building, even a fox climbing on it would break down their wall of stones. Hear us, our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt, or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. So we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the people of Ashdod heard that the repairs to the Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead, and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. Meanwhile, the people of Judah said, The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. Also, our enemies said, Before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and will kill them and put an end to the work. Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, Wherever you turn, they will attack us. Amen. As we move to our musical reflection, as becoming normal, I've got a few questions for you to think about after hearing from God's word. And the first one is, what are all the different ways that the building project is being disrupted? Secondly, what was the response of Nehemiah and the people? And lastly, what are the things that make life difficult for us? The tune and the words that we're about to read and listen to come from Genesis. It's quite a well-known hymn, but I wonder if it's the type of prayer that Nehemiah might have prayed.
Thank you.
If you have a book on apologetics, and that book has a chapter in it on the historical accuracy or the historical evidence for the resurrection, now it doesn't matter who wrote the rest of that book, but very often that chapter will have been written by somebody called Gary Habermas. When I was a young student, I got the chance to go see him debate this very topic with a representative from, I think, the British Humanist Society. I remember waiting in line to get in to the big lecture theatre they had booked out. And in front of me was a student who appeared to be a student of philosophy who had met his lecturer in line in front of him. And I can't remember what they were talking about, but I do remember that I felt I should interject into this conversation of two complete strangers in front of me. And I said something along the lines of, I've read some of Gary Habermas' stuff, and he's really methodical and logical. I'm really interested in what his opponent is going to say. To which the lecturer replied in one of those accents, it's almost like he's actively been cultivating arrogance and condescension in the way he talks. And he said, I assume he's going to say it's a load of rubbish. And I remember thinking, well, I really hope we get more than that. If that's the best they can come up with, I'll be really disappointed. I was really disappointed. The person basically tried to use the story of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs to say that the resurrection was just like a fairy tale. And I don't remember much of the debate, but I remember Gary Habermas quoting scholars that this person had on his website as people to go away and to read, and using those scholars to construct evidence for the resurrection. And then the person replying that, oh yes, well you like your facts and your figures. And then moved on as if to say that they're not important. I couldn't believe it. I thought, we're here to debate evidence and history. But what boiled down to was his best argument was, you don't really believe that, do you? It was mocking, and in the form of ridicule. You don't need any factual ammunition, and you don't even need argument. And it's I've been this. Time and time again, opposition starts with mocking. And this is the situation that Nehemiah and the people of Judah now find themselves in. In chapter 2, Sanballat seems to throw contemptuous scorn upon the people of Judah from a position of superiority as he looks down on them. But now the work has started, and the people of Jerusalem are starting to see results. The emphasis is on his extreme anger. There's an implication that there's the start of a desperation in the voice of Sanballat. The realization of the fact that Nehemiah might actually succeed. This cannot go on. Success will mean Jerusalem's greater security and independence and the heightening of the morale of its people. Sanballat also has his own standing to think about. He has his own men to think about. And what do they think? And so verse 2 notes that he ridiculed the Jews in the presence of his associates. So it was primarily for their benefit. What he was saying was for the benefit of the people round about him first of all, but it was clear it was also intended to be heard by the builders. What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they offer sacrifices? In effect, he's saying, are they going to pray the walls up? Are they hoping that God is going to wave a magic wand over the work and do it all for them? The second pair of insults suggests that the Jews have been hopelessly optimistic. They've bitten off far more than they can chew. The task is bigger and will take longer than they ever imagined. Sambalat tried to deride their abilities, to mock their optimism, to quash their enthusiasm, to undermine their confidence and magnify their problems. Burnt brick was useless for building. It was majorly weakened and it was prone to crumble. It would have been one thing to hear the taunts. It would have been another thing to see the army of Samaria outside the half-built city walls. It was a show of power that was meant to frighten and demoralize. Nehemiah responds with his typical instinctive reaction to a crisis. He prays, "Hear us, O God, for we are despised." To despise one chosen by God is in effect to despise God's way and his plan. And in the Old Testament, that always amounts practically to despising yourself. To work against God is to despise your own life, to throw it away, to waste it. And whereas we love Nehemiah's prayer in chapter 1, it can be a little bit tempting to skip over this one. From our Christian vantage point, we don't quite know what to make of it. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. He's saying, let them suffer what they prescribe for us. But more than that, he's saying, let them suffer what we suffered in exile and are being carried away and taken from our home. When you go through something terrible, you might say something along the lines of, I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy. There is no such compunction for Nehemiah. May they be given over as plunder in a land of captivity. And then to finish his prayer off, he says, let there be no atonement. That's the idea of covering up their sins or blotting out their guilt. Cut off the path back to a favorable position. Don't let them off with it. There is no way back. Nehemiah was angry. He could see the effect the taunts were having and the threat of violence was having on the people working on the wall. And in fact, this prayer itself was probably meant to encourage and to embolden the workers for their benefit. But he also perceived that the real insult was not against them, but against God. Nehemiah prays in a similar way that we see to others in the Old Testament. Jeremiah says, but you, Lord, no other plots to kill me. Do not forgive their crimes or blot their sins out from your sight. Let them be overthrown before you. Deal with them in the time of your anger. There's psalms that are often called psalms of imprecation. And it's psalms like Psalm 35 or 58 or 59 or 69 or 109 or Psalm 137. And if you go and you read them, their content might shock you. We read these things in the Bible and we think, well, is that okay? Those prayers, though, are just exactly that. They're prayers. They're things not said by God to humans, but by man to God. We wonder, what does God make of it? And these prayers are said in a context of significant injustice, oppression, and offense. They are the product of real rage. The question is, if you felt such rage, where would be the proper place for it? If fierce anger needs to be released, it's far better to be expressed in prayer than in uncontrolled bitterness towards others. God knows the reason for our indignations. What Nehemiah's prayer does, and others like it do, is to hand over judgment to God. It is to pray for judgment rather than to take matters into their own hands. It is a desire for justice. And in that sense of handing over, it constitutes a trust in God to bring about judgment and thereby for his honor to be vindicated. But still, these prayers are a far cry away from the exhortations of the New Testament, such as Romans 12. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Or the words of Christ. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. They are a far cry away from the prayer of Jesus, the Son of God, as he hung on a cross and prayed, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. I went to an Eddie Izzard comedy show once years ago, and he started it by saying that he didn't believe in God. And to prove that God wasn't real, he stood at the front of the stage and he called in God to smite him from heaven. And the resultant nothing for him was proof that God wasn't real. What a surprise. More mocking. But I was sitting in my seat and I was raging. I was literally saying to God, do it. Throw it down. It'll serve him right. And then every year we'll learn our lesson. And I realized that day that God's forbearance vastly outlasted mine. God has been far more long-suffering and put up with far worse than the jibes of a media personality. And he does it from a position of power. Despite what we see as somebody's wealth or fame or influence, they are nothing next to God. And that power of forbearance and long-suffering is ours through Christ as we become like him, with his Spirit inside of us, living in us. We become tolerant and forgiving, like Jesus was tolerant and forgiving. Now, Christians react to cruelty and injustice in the light of two great biblical events: the cross of Jesus and the promise of the life to come. Derek Kidner, who's a really famous Old Testament commentator, when he's discussing these cries of vengeance in the Psalms, he talks about how Christians understand these prayers that we come across. And it's worth quoting a few of his lines here. He says this: we should have to suspend our consciousness of having a gospel to impart which affects our attitude to fellow sinners, and our assurance of a final righting of wrongs, which affects our attitude to present anomalies. Without these certainties, only a cynic could feel no impatience to see justice triumphant and evil men broken. And those authors were no cynics. It would be better, in fact, to speak of their attuning our ears to the gospel than of our adjusting to their situation. for we cannot truly hear its answers until we have felt the force of their questions. For many of us who ask, is it okay to pray a prayer like Nehemiah's prayer? We're fortunate because we've been spared the circumstance in which we might pray a prayer like Nehemiah's prayer. Upon hearing that the repairs had continued and the gaps were being closed by the opposition, were angered even more. And the opposition has been continually increasing throughout the story of Nehemiah. First we had Sanballat and Tobiah, and then they were joined by Geshem, the Arab, and now we have Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the people of Ashdod. The people of Ashdod fill a gap in the northeast, so now Jerusalem is completely surrounded by hostility. These people together came to stir up trouble. And even if to appear with weapons was a bluff, or spreading rumors of attack was just rumors, it was meant to disrupt the building. Could it be that Sanballat was even responsible for the destruction of the walls that were reported to Nehemiah in chapter 1? Those in Jerusalem who had experienced the earlier setback of their building being forced to stop, which would have been the vast majority of them, would not have stopped to consider the legalities of the threats that were going against royal authority of Artaxerxes. The characteristic response of prayer and action is again the two complementary ways used to face each developing situation. Nehemiah, far from looking for that magic wand from God, shows a keen awareness of human responsibility that derives from divine sovereignty. I have a guitar, which is a very different sentence from I play the guitar. And one of the things that I love doing is when somebody visits the house, which has been a long time now, but when someone can visit the house and they are good at playing guitar, I love them just sitting on it playing it, and I can hear what it's supposed to sound like. But imagine the person who has a guitar and just says, it's a terrible guitar, it does nothing, it just sits there in the corner buying dust, it's useless, I've never heard it make a sound or play any music. A bit puzzled and bemused, you'd say, if you want to hear music, you have to play it. The difference between the person who says that about a guitar they don't play and the person who says, I've never seen God do anything special in my life or work anything powerful, is that you don't need any talent or experience or musical ability to get going with God. There's nothing stopping you. If you want to see God work, you need to get involved in it. And that goes for the wonderful miracles that are wrought inside us, as well as the mighty acts that are done around us. God chooses, in the most part, to work through us. It's a special privilege given to us, as much as it is a responsibility. It would be a disgraceful dishonor if the task was taken away from us because we were unwilling to take part. The end of our passage leaves us on a somber note. The workers are tired. They've been working flat out and they are only halfway. They worry that the task is too big for them, and they doubt in their power to complete it. It was a natural sinking feeling at the halfway mark of a large task, and it was exacerbated by the taunts and violent threats of those outside the city. The words that the people say are in the rhythm of a Hebrew lament poetry, where the second line is shorter than the first, and the line leaves you feeling like it's come up short in the way that they feel like life has left them feeling short. And they say, and also our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them, and we'll kill them and put an end to the work. Then the Jews lived near them, came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. Nehemiah typically seems resolutely confident throughout the encounter. His typical reaction of prayer and action together showed his trust in God. We too are called to put our trust in God, to commit to Him, to affirm our faith in prayer, to share our anxieties, acknowledge our weaknesses, and confess our need, and then to step out. Or in Nehemiah's case, and for the people of Judah, to keep stepping out, to keep on keeping on. Grammatically, verse 12, where we stopped, and verse 13 are linked to each other. But I very deliberately put the split there, because the answer doesn't always come in the next verse. Meanwhile, the people in Judah said, the strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. Also, our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them, and will kill them and put an end to the work. Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. It was hard. It was hard for Nehemiah and for the people of Judah. They were tired and they were unsure of the end. At the 6th month point of dealing with these COVID restrictions, a lot of people shared the words of someone who spoke of experience of dealing with different crises around the world. And she said that there's always something of a wall in the 6th month mark. And it was reminding us to be kind to ourselves and not to expect too much from our own output. Times are hard for people who maybe face an uncertain health diagnosis or even a terminal diagnosis, who either can't see an end or who know that they will never be without the disease. For people who grieve or mourn and wonder if they'll ever feel different, times are hard. When we face opposition, when in certain ways we suffer, even just when we find that we lose motivation and oomph, when we're angry and frustrated, it's hard. And if you're finding that for yourself things are hard just now, you're not alone. Nehemiah and the people of Judah struggled. Our biblical heroes struggled. I struggle, and the people around you struggle. We all need restorative rest. We need self-care in order that when we give of ourselves, we give from a position of fullness and not from emptiness. One of the commentaries on Nehemiah has a lovely phrase. It says, yet however intense, adversity is never a solitary visitor to the soul. It never comes by itself, but is always accompanied by something else from God. It is in these very times of difficulty that can be the most fertile ground for the growth of our relationship with God. When we call out to him and we find him faithful, and we know that because of these experiences, we can trust him not just on our earthly future, but to lead us past that as well. These times can enhance our sensitivity to others, to strengthen our resilience and help us reflect on ourselves. They can strengthen our dependence on God and even create space for his Spirit to work, but they're hard. And so rather than berate ourselves for tiredness or for doubting our ability or for negative emotions, we bring them to God in prayer, and we reaffirm our commitment to God. We might not have a script from Nehemiah this time round of what to pray, but we do know because of Nehemiah that whatever we feel, the proper place for it is before God, and there is nothing that we need to hide from him. We are invited to pray with passion and with honesty. These things that pull us down, we hand over to God and to his justice and his care and his love. So as we come to pray now, I invite each of you to think of something specific, either in your own life or in someone you know, where the situation is hard. And let's bring it before God. Lord God of heaven, we trust in your goodness and your justice. We trust in your honor, in your love and your care. And we trust in your power. But oftentimes our heart. And each of these things that we have brought before you in our own hearts, we lay at your feet, handing them over to you, asking for your help, your power to be evident in our lives and in the lives of those we love. Lord God, bring justice, bring healing, bring vindication of righteousness, bring reconciliation. May we be astounded by the mighty acts that you do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be upon you, now and forevermore. Amen.